right, guys. Ladies and gentlemen, sorry. First of all, thank you for coming tonight. My name is Steve Blackley. I'm the Development High Performance Manager here at Frankston. Obviously, we put the flyer out. We are heading in towards rep tryouts. Model 1 to 12, the four school holidays, the rest of them are after school holidays. We are looking at expanding the size of our association with junior teams for the BJBL competition, so increase the number if we need increased coaches. So obviously we put the word out to any of the domestic coaches that want to get involved in Friday night competition and coaching a junior rep team. So thank you for coming down and giving up your time for that. I'm going to be around at the end of the clinic to talk to you individually and all that sort of stuff. We're definitely an association on the rise. You've seen the big posters and stuff out before you with the new stadium development, and we are going full steam ahead with a lot of the high performance areas, the coach development, player development, and things like that. It's kind of an exciting time for the peninsula, I think, over the next 18 months or so. And so looking forward to hopefully getting some of you guys involved in the Blues for the next coming season. But I'm happy to, after the clinic, stick around and have a chat individually on what your thoughts are. So am I right to say that all of you are at least interested in maybe doing some further coaching? Beautiful. Any age group in particular? No? Doesn't matter. Under 12, that's what I was hoping to hear. I was hoping to hear some under 12s, because that's probably going to be our busiest and biggest age group. We just started a rep ready program on Thursday night. The kids that haven't played rep before, we've already got 120 Blues kids in the under 12 age group, and we had another 140 kids turn up on Thursday that haven't played rep before. So it's a really. Yes, sir. No, they just go straight to tryouts. Yeah, the 05 kids. No, only do it for the under 12s, otherwise it was. Yeah, we have a camp during school holidays. So that leads up to it as well. So otherwise, if we did a rep ready for every age group, we'd have enough days in a week. So you guys are lucky to have Tony running the clinic today. He's really well experienced and does a really good job presenting and things like that. So I'll hand over to him. I'll be around out and about, and then be here at the end to speak to you guys individually and stuff as well. So,
thanks, Steve. Thanks, everybody, for coming. And nice to see you and to be here today. First of all, a big thank you to yourselves for, first of all, taking the step of the plunge from being basketball coaches, and also I compliment you and thank you for coming today. I'd like to learn more about it and talk as much information as you can. Most coaches I've come across have really started in the same position you are, and I'll ask you probably if this sounds familiar, but you know, you're sitting on the sidelines, summer quarter or family and friend was playing basketball and someone said, hey, our team hasn't got a coach. Can you fill in? Does that sound familiar to some people? Do you like that advice? And that's generally how all the 99% of our coaches, not in our sport, but all sports, get started. You know, it's through a family friend, family member, through your own child and your own children. Thank you very much for accepting that challenge and taking it on. It can be no problem if you're working one at a time, but I can assure you it's one of the most rewarding steps you've taken. And hopefully that you feel that way already, and I'm sure that you'll get through the coaching and feel the same way through that experience. A bit about me. I'm very fortunate that the case is very, very good to me. I'm born and bred in the outback of WA, and I've always played bush footy. But I was lucky for the city and family I boarded with. task force, they drag you along that whole sun's line, and they drag you along that. And I assume quickly switch to basketball, footy just became so we shoot hoops. So I was lucky, I was coming through an era where the sport was growing. The Wildcats were the biggest thing in the state and the country, around the world, obviously. So after a short-lived playing career, I then switched to coaching, officiating. I've been very lucky in my country, I've been all around the world, I've been different places in this country, and I've seen some fantastic things, and then some wonderful people. So that's just where the sport has taken from. And most of us just come from humble beginnings, and we're just off to the right place at the right time. But also the first knowledge that so I thank you for the compliment and for working with you. Perhaps Cynthia, if I could put in small groups, we can do this. If you don't mind just giving me a bit of about yourself, I'll go from you and I'll end up here. Perhaps how you started, your play, who you're playing, totally coaching, what age you're playing here. Right, so we've worked, everyone here from different backgrounds and areas, but for the common theme and reason for it. So don't ever discount your life skills or your history in other areas or other sports that you've participated in, because all that really helps you and transfers into coaching and certainly to basketball. You know, there's a lot of things that also transfer from other sports into any sport. Sneak into a rugby union clinic or a netball clinic or a soccer clinic, and I'll pick up just little things that people say. It might be one or two words, but I'll always write little things down I see, and it's amazing how those on concept can be transferred into classrooms. So, you know, we used to never think last year, they talked a lot about space, and space is a big fundamental aspect of classroom. And it was really interesting to hear how they talked about space and how space, you know, is applied and paramount and therefore. And you know, I straight away took some points of that. So I'm on the right track here. I'll go ask you what you'd like to get out of today. Anything specific you'd like to cover? I've got the set curriculum there and agenda, but I like to pay these things to the audience themselves. So, something good work. So yeah, so repertoire of drills is something you build up over a lifetime, and really just observing people, asking people, you know, and some of the best drills I've picked up is, you know, coach, you know, do a session in or next to me, and you know, because the age of working with you sort of came to apply to best as appropriate. Also, I mean, now on the internet, there's, you know, an endless supply of drills, just put a search engine, tap away. There's probably a good dozen websites, mainly in the US, that you can get drills from. And some subscribe to, some you get for free. And there's also some stuff around Australia which they're getting better at doing. We've never been great at it, but we're getting better at it. Side of Australia. There's drill now. There's not really one that has a central point for drills yet. Some of the state bodies have different stuff on their websites. Some of the organised clubs have some different stuff on their websites. Yeah, but unfortunately, it's so the vast majority don't have any more stuff on their website too. Yeah, which is good. I know. Since Kristen Beals has been here, it's about 12 months now, she's the she's put a lot of stuff on their website. This part of today includes who drills and this sort of thing. Secure the concept you go through, I don't want to see all the terrific. So, on average, just how long does people have to train? Half an hour, 40 minutes an hour, 45 generally. And half court, full court, indoor, outdoor?
Half court indoor.
Half court indoor, half court indoor. Challenging, that's part of adapting and being a showing flexibility in the coach. So we'll work on a couple of things to do in that 45 minutes to start with. If we look at your general practice, 45 minutes after all, just roughly what sort of things, how people sort of structure it. So what are we doing first, straight up? Horseshoe. Yeah. The opposition. Horseshoe, heat beater, that's quite a few good things. Yeah, the opposition. You're doing it. Same thing. Yeah. Similar.
Thank you.
So in your time, 45 minutes, I'd recommend that you probably spend no more than 10 minutes. Because after 10 minutes, you won't retain as much, they don't retain as much, and that's when you might start getting bored or impatient or wanting to move on. And bear in mind, a 40 to 45 minute session, if you're spending 10 minutes on a drill, you're only going to get four drills in there, four different concepts, then plus say maybe half a one, or some time there for a drink or stretch or recap or whatever you really gain. So just be conscious of that time. And I'm saying, when I'm doing a 2 hour session, I only really work on 10 to 15 maximum, really go 10 really maximum drill, and I'll try and get 80 in there at a stage. Now, next time for wrap up at the end, please time for a little bit of scrimmage, please time for drink breaks and prep break as well. So be there, just be conscious about that. And ensuring that, short, so the way to leave it is in a game situation, we're not playing scrimmages. I know it's great, that's a part of sharing that knowledge and information and people's experience. Trust me, I have nowhere near the answer to the world. I learn as much when I do this as I do it myself. Interaction. In a game situation, I would just encourage you to put certain challenges in place. So rather than just have a kid's scrimmage, which ends up generally after about 90 seconds, which is just ending up to be. We try and put in some challenges. So, four passes before we shoot. Maximum two dribbles only each person. We've got to run out of some certain small structure organisation you want to do. Then you might say, right, we're going to have a pass that the post has got to catch the ball at least once. And those types of things. We've got to have, we want to put a time limit on it or a score limit on it. We might say, right, a lot of things I do in groups, which is any kind of scenario. So I say, right, the score is five all, and we've got 3 minutes to see who wins. We might say it's the scores are 10-8, and the team is on top, has got the ball, and you've got 3 minutes to try and if you score up. Just got those types of little things, and there's really lots of cool scenarios we do. Put some challenges in place. When I scrimmage, I also tend to get points, not for points for scoring, but for other things. So we'll give a point for a defensive rebound, 2 points for an offensive rebound, point for a turnover, maybe a point for assist, or 2 points for a charge, point for a steal, so that we accumulate points not on score. So we might say, right, the score's worth 1 point. Whether you shoot a 3 or 2 or 1 or whatever, it's worth 1 point. You give extra points for the other thing. They will say, it's discretionary, a good play or whatever the case might be. So we'll sort of try and modify the games slightly, so the kids all dust and don't think make a lapse and and have the dominant players and dribble the ball and throw the ball around and dominate the screen a bit. We also have a lot of defensive players as well. Things like also you might modify the scrimmage so that you might get 2 defensive stops in a row to change to offense, or you've got to get, might say you get 3 defensive stops, or you've got to get 2 clean defensive rebounds to get out of defensive offense. So we often apply those types of but it's also challenges so that kids are thinking about the other aspects of the game. You know, how do we control the game defensively? How do we get the game defensively? How do we get rebounds? You know, those types of things. It might be something to say, right, you know, you've got to do two box outs. You've got to get front position on every shot. All those types of things. Yeah, for example, say, right, if you've got to push, deny a corner on the drive, if you let people go middle, then that's a fail. You know, then there's a point against you for those types of things. So really quite specific things in those environments so that they're understanding the principles of what you're teaching and training. You're bringing them down to the game scenario and they can actually experience how that applies in the game and all up to the core of what I'm teaching. And therefore challenge them to actually think that applying those things that they can teach them. Is there any others that have seen or do, or as far as modifying the game is concerned? In modifying the games, you know, how you might restrict or put challenges in place on the players that we think a bit more about what we're doing. Training session or teaching position or a 45-minute training session. So I encourage people to look at the length of the season, how much time they've got with them, and work out the, you know, the two or three things you really, really want to get done with the group over the course of the season. And understand that it's, it takes season upon season upon season upon season to master some of the skills. They say in our sport it takes about 10 years to develop an injury from and even longer sometimes, but that constant solid training, and these people who athletes be training, you know, 11, 12 months a year, 10 years straight to get to be really good. And some longer. So if you're looking at, you know, all groups, all training, your age group, and how do they learn, how do they develop, it's all information that's going to take time to get through. So that's why I say, if things aren't working, don't be scared to come short and move on to the next thing. You come back the next week, the week after, the month after, and so on and so forth. Just keep reinforcing that. You'll see slowly, steps to slow growth. It's a journey you'll take on, bring it with you. So definitely I'm big advocate for teaching this to pass, catch, and count. If there's one thing that we do, you know, continue to develop our kids, and one thing that is probably going to be our spirit of partnership as a country we're playing nationally, is our ability to cut, ability to pass, ability to catch. If you watch the movements this last 2 weeks, that's one thing they've done really well. It's why they went away from what they were doing well, that's what I struggle with. Yeah, so if you looked at the first week of the group game, they back-cutted everyone, the movement off the ball was second to none, better than any other nation had seen. And that's all from that core fundamental pass, catch, and cut. So look, dribblers are a school that's got to learn absolutely. Preference, I'll prioritise and say, well, they're the sort of three things we do in the training section to get kids into that mode. And then obviously we'll work on some shooting stuff, and then we'll work on some, you know, dribbling. I mean, dribbling's probably the one I do the least, so I'm criticised for that. But I'm also saying to kids, well, if you're learning to dribble up, you can get the ball to your dad any time. You can dribble two balls up and down the street to school every day, and you can have a dribble for 6 months' time. I don't think you can do that to anyone. You can punch on any YouTube clip, and see some gambling or depending on these folks and doing this Ruby George you just speak a whole lot wider than you teach how to do it. Just watch some NBA games, watch Steph Curry, heck the ball and you'll pick up whatever you want. And sometimes we'll do it, that's the best way kids learn. Just throw something in their face, you know, show them if you want of the NBA and they'll pick it up and they'll run themselves, they'll need to get going. Next week you see them all lose, which is much better than, you know, some of the people on the show. But at the moment, it's a bit rough season.
So good to do
When kids are on the break their hands, I say, you know, like sometimes you get this, if you're not an hand, you're going to be the best.
But sometimes it's just your mind. It's good. Just the drive.
So your drill, would you say, twice a month?
Twice a month.
Yeah.
think if you're trying to keep sort of right-handed and shooter, pad shoot, like remove the element of running of the ring, remove the element of the bounce ball, just have it there, shoot their left hand with that motion, and bits and pieces like that, you get 1 second release, and then a second, then like you're dumbing it down, and just like doing the left hand shoot that goes down, 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 back, 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 back,
back, back, back, back, back, back, muscle memory and my repetition. So a couple of things that I do as habits of the so in some of those that drills the scrimmage that we have, I might start, I might say right the first, you know, 90 seconds, every dribble's with on dominant hand to start there. Every drill we do, if it's predominantly right-handed group, and that's not the case, some of the groups are 6 lefty, right. But most groups we dominant right hand. I'll start every drill with the left hand first and then go to the right hand. Not start right left, start non-dominant first and then go to the left. And everything we do, I would spend that little bit extra time on left before we go to right, always. And I'm always constantly putting rules around left and right hand. So if we're doing drilling drills or we're doing individual drills, I'll always say, right, we'll start left hand and then come back to the right. Start right because I'm apparently keep going right. And if we're doing offensive stuff, I always start with left hand side of the ball. So if you notice most of your kids, what will happen is in their normal discipline, and that's in their normal habits of play coming out of the floor, they have that side of the floor. So what I've built is stuff here. So some of the things that I have on the kit always, post something these things are different. Yep, you're bowling in that for like 10 bucks or something. I use it around the floor for positions, four spots, beaters, hoppers, always grab a phone for you, $5 for everything. So what I'll often do is when doing structure stuff, I'll just put the phone on the floor, just up here. Slowly off there, spread the part on, make a start, everything on this side of the pose. If they go that side, yeah, it's a penalty or it's a violation, you know, to turn over or whatever the case is. And just start to get the kids to just understand their mindset, it's okay to be on the side of the floor, it's not that they don't be scared. So that often helps with the confidence of people that keep going as well. And I'll do it also with the left knees on the left. So it's just be conscious all the time and just keep reinforcing that word for the things on the left hand. Anything else you need tips on that or questions out there? Yeah, well, I use it with every training session. I've said this in the long run, and these are the things out of the form. They help them out. So these are some drills to bring these down where you want them to go. The worst thing is to set up a drill, you've been doing it 2%, and the kids are all over the place. Nobody knew where you asked them to go. So these come very handy. Front, this will work on the snap. So just simply, from the this list in place, so I can fix anything else that's wrong. Once they're out here, to get the email, it's almost impossible to get that done. Something that you might be able to do. Shane Hill was great, he had the worst shoe style ever, but he just was relentless and persistent with it. Yeah, left and right hands, yeah, through your point, both hands. Then I said, well, then I said, oh, we'll step out. Now you can bring your non-shooting hand in place. So when all hands are simple, the simple techniques, you call toe, beef, you know, bend the elbows, eye, follow through. So we're looking at, you know, toes slightly, you know, shoulder width apart, probably, also probably our hips apart. You know, one, I always emphasize one foot in front of the other, really, really important. So, you know, strong side foot. Right-handed, my right foot, toe, knee, elbow, eye, follow through, all in line, and then we extend up to here. So now we've got the left hands in place, the left hands, non-shooting finger, 10 fingers pointed at the basket, thumb pretty much is in the centre of the hand, and as we're raising up, the left hand extends as well, so that's the 5 fingers of the non-shooting hand, the guiding hand, pointing at the ring. Shooting hand extends and the fingers reach into the basket. So we call that reach with the cookie jar or follow through with the empty deck, whatever you want to tell the kids that they can be familiar with. And we just get to get that repetition of this all the time. And making sure that it's really important with the kids that toes, knees, hips, torso, chest are always facing the rim. For the same deal, boys, just shoot, bring down the room, just shoot.
Thank you.
same foot, same hand. Same foot, same hand. Step. So we're teaching kids to step first. We're starting to stand, they've got a pure foot, and they step first to get distance, and then they drill. So step, dribble, one, two. The reason why we do it is to teach them to think getting in the habit of stirring up, shot faking, and going to the basket.
Keeping that balance all the time, weight evenly distributed all the time,
low center of gravity, that the ball would work. Same with the shot frame. So when he goes up, you want the weight down through both feet. So from here, go back into his shot, or he can go left or right. But if he's picking himself up in the shot frame, got that, and try to fake that he can't move at all. So that's really important. Body low, hips low, minimal foot movement, let the ball do the work. So that's shot fake. Good. Jab set. Good. And last one is passing. Same thing, body's low, hips are low, the ball's doing the work. So 2 hands pass in front, yeah, pass to the left, pass to the right, yeah, pass overhead. Yeah, all that kind of stuff. Yeah. So just make sure the kid's got their low base, low set of gravity, and the ball's doing all the work. So there's the three. They're the three. Full face, and I'd encourage them. Repetition of those into everything you think is going to do before they dribble, and they ball fake. Before they shoot, it's going to be ball fake. And teach the kids to come off the ball fake to do, you know, the two or three things they need to do. Sure, be a ball fake shoot, ball fake dive, ball fake pass, you know, and all those sorts of things. Any questions for that? Happy with that sort of things? So, double the shooting, one of the simple drills we do as well to teach the kids to pass, catch, and cut, and boot is also just a simple three-minute drill in the perimeter. So, I'll just grab by again, if you don't mind. So I just need one more person, so let's come out. Try this. So this is what I like to use on warm-ups as well. We'll go left first and then right. So Wayne's going to receive that, and he's going to be the person who will lay up. That's target is two hands target out instead of one hand in the case of all two hands. And we're then emphasizing outside passing outside hand to outside hand. Now the reason why we emphasize outside hand to outside hand is that if Wayne's catch Wayne's passing is a high and high Wayne's defense on the hand lane, these catches are inside hand to inside hand, I'm going to steal them. But teaching your players to catch outside hand to outside hand ensures the defense score 9 out of 10 doesn't get hit at the ball. So this one, what we do is we say, well, we've done pass and catch on the player. Now we do pass and catch back ball lane. So what that means is that when we get the ball to high, Daniel's going to cut, he's going to make a bounce pass, he's going to make a lane. Stretch target outside hand, nice, sweet, good, sweet. He's going to go and make a pass. Yeah, nice. So we go forward, pivot on this one. Good, 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 nice. Now we're going to go reverse pivot on this one. Good. I do, but I also allow them to experiment as well. So I'm running the ring. Yeah. Really the young age, I really emphasize getting that footwork right and sure that it's left, right, knee up, shoot the ball. But then also as they get a bit older, I also like to understand what's called the upper arm as well. It's going on. Hand, because when you get to when you play at high level, you're playing against better athletes, you've got the ball out there, it often gets exposed to a block, you're going up the knees, and often, so you should be watching, if you're watching Andrew Gaze, maybe before the play up, he was always his inside elbow, master, so he, when he's going to move on the left side, he always going to walk the play up his right hand, and that was because he could protect the ball.
Thank you.
take longer to get the result by the hand, the shot by. But if you forgo that, it's really hard. Sorry, it's harder to come back. So reverse layups are the principles of the footwork, the steps, the hand, all the same as a normal layup, except it's on the reverse side of the rim. So it's not reversing the technique, it's on the reverse side. Thank you. Dell on the floaters at the front of the ring. That's out there. It's a fantastic move. Great for yards. Probably the smaller than the other two Dells. A move I adopted at early age. The only good thing, I was coming to the hoop, I was never going to shoot the ball over the big guy, so I learned to use a running little chunk of floater. So the same thing as a layup, coming in off my shooting right hand, coming in my left foot, just putting the left foot down, getting that right knee up, right hand up, and shoot the ball up the muscle by just turning, again, a long jump into a high jump. And that's the whole thing. So, and then same from the left hand side, left hand, right foot, throwing up nicely. A really good little skill to teach you to shoot up from the front of the ring, coming down the middle of the lane. But really, that's all. That's really what's happening. Yeah. So when we do layup, we're talking about layup to the chair, and the layup thing as well. Again, more timing, and layup to the baseline and the first one as well. And then that's really good. They can do those three. Bang on. Reverse the baseline, get Bill, and they continue to give this time each one of those during the season. And that's all the labs. Sort of keep the distance just above the top. Keep going. Yeah, just about this one. So, try and down your pass ball for each other. Both of them trying to tap on it. And we'll normally go to, say, 30 seconds each person, and we'll record how many taps they get or how many fingertips when trying to steal the ball. And that's their point of award. The seeker gets the most points. The rules are these. Learning all these guys have got it, they can't pass over Wayne's hand. They've got to pass through his. For example, we've got to pass through his also body. Wayne's going to try and trace the ball with two hands. So emphasising thumbs and fingers are looking for that area and trying to make the ball covering. Well, the reason why I emphasise that is that if I trace the ball with two hands, I'm keeping the ball in front of a target or an object. If I split my hands, then straight away I'm creating a passing angle. So this is opposed to this, as you can see. I create passing gaps if I split my hands up. So I always try to put that side of this. So follow the trace ball to this, and that way you get more chance of getting fingertips. Again, body low, hips low, and have a go. Here we go. Yep. Good. When you receive the catch, just hold it for half a second for tight to come and close out on you. So now I'll introduce the close out and I say, right, on the catch, you've got to be right, two hands up over the ball, hips low, body low. So we're starting to introduce pressure on the ball. So I'm starting to use the passes, I'm going to get used to being guarded by someone all the time. So on that catch, first he's going to see me catch the ball from this all over the ball. Okay? Good. So again, we'll count the tap, we'll count the back tap. We'll count the taps and then we'll move on. He's got the opposite problem. But it's certainly like that rule of practice about that's a great rule.
Yeah.
Not pass the same person twice. Then you can run the grip order to say everyone's going to touch the ball this course should be. So again, passing rules, you can Google them. But some of the basic ones are off the best ones. And again, one thing I really emphasise with the kids is about that hip body work, foot work. So I might just quite a number of your hand put so to help get their technique right, we just always do straight passes. But in a game, very rarely leading him straight. The only time people lead is probably in transition when you move the ball from the back point to the front. That's the only time you have to pass this clean attack. So for a beginning to get the footwork right. So what I say to the kids is every pass you do, the hips are low. Every time you throw the pass, you step forward the foot. The next time you're more staying in position. Okay, so that's the right rule. Balance. The exercise of that extending your arm. And I say to the kids, thumbs down, fingers are targets, how we finish, or some coaches they do it to cows, or all kinds of little phrase they can do it. But I say, or bat your palms touched, but I say, thumb down at the end of the target, that's how we finish. And always 10 finger targets to receive. So I say this, we shoot the ball with one hand, and pass the ball with two, pass the catch with two. Sure, we don't do it. Just begin there.
I'm not teaching you anything. I'm not teaching you how to catch the ball. And sure, my pass
That's really the damage. Very, really need to get the perfect pups. So I'm teaching you the perfect situation to pop the game. I'm teaching you to catch a hard pass. All the top feet on passes, I can drop my skills, strips the my passes, and also obviously drop his catches as well. So, thanks, mate. Any questions for that? Happy with those? Any more? You'll see how the pass they like to add in, throw around.
You do the voice on the Steve Boyd for both of
them. Yeah, sort of saying. Voice communication is on two-way street.
Yeah.
It's on pass and catch. Yeah. So voice only pass, voice only catch. The reason I said that the voice for the top pass on the fly, then he knows past it. And that's just a tool that we need to practice as we go. Just going to help him understand that there's a difference between past it and the voice Dan, do you want to jump up for a second? We'll do a couple of others. Yeah, some of the last stuff. So with that passing drill, where you might understand it just a better, a better part, we'll also get to that drill where we're moving around as well. So that is forward, left, and right. So he's moving target, I'm moving target. But also catch the ball, jumps on each one. Kids understand that as soon as you release the ball, you're going to move to the spot, but also that when you pass, you pass to someone on the move. Now, starting with the spacing side of things, so what I'll do is I'll say, we want a minimum space of about 12 feet all the time between each and every player. So, we've got to do that drill the same way, you can't come close to 12 feet, but also you've got to be conscious of your other teammates. You can't go closer than them in 12 feet. So find the group next to us, and then move this way, then we've got to move away to create the space. So I'll start to introduce that in the drills and on the floor in the half court when we're doing stuff to ensure the players are constantly aware of what's happening around them. Not only is there the space in the wheel, but ensuring there's space around the court as well. And I work on the 12 foot list. Everything we do, 12 feet, 12 feet. When we do line drills, 12 feet away from each other. You know, if we're running drills or anything else, it's always 12 feet. But the way you measure that is jump on that. That's where these things come in. So you want to be nice, high and wide on the floor, on our wing floor spots. So wide outside the elbow anyway. So above the free throw line here slightly. Nice and wide outside, you know, the line. Some of them say that the older athletes, I'll say it's in line with the, if you continue to straight line at 3-point line, that's how we be. If you do a few, don't go that far out because they get pushed towards the sideline, but also the distance is preferred as well. And then you'll say that you want to be somewhere in that area, not on the block, because that's where the defense is, you want to be above the block or below the block. Either one. So a lot of the when we do passing drills, and two person drill, we'll do the drill in a location that would when you pass the ball to the game. So where Dan and Kai and I were doing it, I wouldn't necessarily do the drill here because that's not where you like to pass the ball to the game. But I might do it from here to there, so I might have daylight in that building again. My eyes. And then you might pass from there to simulate where you're passing again. Or from there, or from there. Off the elbow again. So you see we're starting to get the concept.
Rest assured, you can teach your kids to make entries around the
post like that, you put your post on it, match up to the middle, you pierce the relocate down below, you're already doing it. It's a hell of a service. And, you know, when they come to 14 to 16, they're really going to know how to play the half ball. So, when they're getting kids to move around the perimeter, I teach them to slide around the perimeter. So they're ready now, ready to shoot. So, if we go up to this one here, the slide, and below, that's ready to pass the shoot. Slide back up. Here, we're going to the top one, we'll sprint. Down low, ready to go. We might, then we might slide back this one. Down right, ready to go, all the time. So keep the body low on the perimeter, the hips low, 10 fingers up all the time. So, that there will really help with the spacing side of things. The next thing was probably a look at work on the defensive side of things. So in the training session, I always, it depends on the circumstances and your time, but I was always taught to probably devote over 50% of the sessions to defensive work. Now that doesn't mean that you spend 50% of time doing slides on the other floor. It means that, you know, in the drills you're doing, there's got to be some defensive aspect to it. And this is that passing we did before with Dwayne and Kai. Dan, there was defense as well, so they got a sense of that. And then you put a bit of the drills, the passing drills, and we do always add some differences. So when we do a drill, I look at some differences. So the kids are meeting, visualize a bit, understand what the impact and why that is against defense. So two types of defense, on ball and off ball. That's pretty much about it. And on ball, it's just, the rules are quite simple. Teach kids to sustain front, to simply keep personally guarding the front. That's really what it becomes about. And we teach kids to read the torso, read the number, you know, look at the name if they've got, you know, thanks to blues across their top or whatever it might be, or the name of their club or their team, then you focus on that. Or if it's a number, we say, well, you focus on the uniform number, because wherever the number goes, that's where the body's going, which makes where the person's going. They just focus on that stage front, and then fine. The next stage is teach them to get out of stance, get into stance, out of stance, back into stance. So it's a defensive stance. Again, a great music on it. Got a bit of defense about you. This face is very boring. I actually don't stand facing me. So defense stance, hips low, shoulders about, feet about shoulder apart. Okay, back straight, and just look forward a bit so it's a bit spot. Yep, nice. And we just say, you just pretend you're sitting on the floor. So just sit back and down, backside down, push back straight a little bit. Yep, push your hips low, and so that your head is pretty much not over in front of your knees, but your weight is forward, but just behind your nose, here, just behind on the needs and low centre ground. And you should have a strong baseline can't push you over, strong baseline can't push you over, and strong base so you're not going to fall over if I push you forward. So, and the reason I said is to teach the kids to get out of the habit of lunging and reaching and staying in stance and moving your feet. And then obviously hand movement is as important as foot movement. I mean 90% of kids foul with their hands, and you know, the odd block foul here and there. So teaching kids to control their hands, teaching kids to use their hands as a tool of defense and not a liability of foul is really important. So I teach the hand movement from the start. And a simple thing I use is we call dig and deflect. So inside hand is digging up at the ball, outside hand is deflecting passes and shots. And simply, if I'm shooting with my right hand, then it's his left hand over my right. If it's his right hand over my right, he's giving me that area to shoot. So left hand over right, or if I'm left hand shooting, the other hand's up, and this hand digging all the time. So if I'm bringing the ball and I'm crossing over to dribble, so I've got the ball here, he's deflected that, I can't get on there, so the next move is to here. My next movement is for his hand to meet the ball. And so straight away that's slowing my ability to cross over and my ability to make a move and my ability to meet him. And that's pressure. That pressure really comes down to those two things. Ball pressure here, I can't make this pass, walk down this side, or here, the next pressure's there, or the hand's there. If I'm trying to cross over, the hand's digging at the ball. If I bring the ball at this side of the basket, he's digging the whole time, digging for the ball. So for me to get out of this area, my movement has to be like this. Three. Build pressure again, and straight away you're pushing the object out of the comfort zone. So really important, we emphasise, you know, the message to the kids is really just staying in front, keeping the player in front of you at all times, you know, focus on the areas of the body, the uniform, the number, the name, whatever you can find, and make sure where the ball goes, or where the torso goes, is where the body goes. Now footwork comes, a bit of defensive footwork we'll teach you. Big stance, bigger stance, big stance. So, if Daniel's down his stance now, that's what we call big stance. We need to go bigger stance on the first movement, and then back to big stance. So bigger stance means his foot's got to be wider. So whichever direction I'm moving in, is where his feet extends, so he gets to a bigger stance. So big stance, bigger stance, back to big. Bigger, big. Bigger, big. Go this way, bigger, big. Bigger, big. Bigger, big. Right. One of the simple tools we used to do with the kids to help them out is just get a 30 centimeter foot ruler, drill two holes in it, tie a couple of lacky bands in it, put the lacky bands around their ankles. Can't bring their feet together any closer than 30 centimetres. And teach them to stretch out, stretch out, stretch out all the time, and bring it to a certain place. So, and there's a million other things you can do with the part of teaching the angles of the bigger motion, and you can do all the sliding drills you can imagine. What sort of things we do is we start on the sideline, and we'll grab just to simply get into that concept, and we'll pick a distance, put a cone out, and say, right, everyone's got to get out from the line in three slides, or two slides, or four slides, or whatever case we emphasise. I generally work with the principle of three to four slides, and then the next concept is teach them to get out of stance and back into stance. Because very rarely, well, no time to go if you stay in stance for all that period of time. So, one of the really important aspects of the skill of defense is understanding how to be in stance and out of stance. So often what I'll do across the board, I'll have a cone here and another cone on the other side of the floor. Look out here. And then another one again, and we'll say, right, slide the cone, run to the next cone, slide the next cone. So just do it on the trip, so nice and slow. So bigger here. Now on this spot here, just come back. One of the things we'll get the habit of the kids is turning and sprinting out of their stance. So it's like a 100 metre dash. So when he's down nice and low, his forward toe points, his back toe points, and he gets his heel over toe, knee down and forward. Knee down and forward. So from there, it's like a 100-meter dash. And so from there, it's a sprint to the next one, 1, 2, 3, 4 sprints. And get down, stands again, face the line. He's back in the stance, and then you slide again. Bigger, big, bigger, big, bigger, big, and then sprint the line again. So we might do that with the whole group, some of that's a warm-up drill, and getting them out of that big, bigger, big, bigger, big sprint, big, bigger, big sprint. So in stance, out of stance, in stance. Or do that on the floor, across the floor, coming in, coming out, beginning to understand the angles and diagonals, and then we'll start doing the form as well. So they fear it and track it. And do it up so we get the office.
Thank you.
This versus here, job is to block that new passage there.
Sure.
And if this person comes in with his head, he goes that way, to the top there, and throws it to the bottom. So we've got on ball here, so you're seeing ball, deny, so bend. So bend is the same on the principle, which is one step towards ball. There's other ways of doing it, open stance or closed stance, or just go closed stance. So inside of the hand is your left hand. Yeah. In the lane here, arm face the ball, come here. And we can go shoot the ball for a kick out. We'll see if I feel, we want to get that done. everyone's can't hold the ball, touch the ball. Scores. Does anyone else have any ideas on that? Any thoughts, Rex? There's some theories of coaches have to say that kids don't get out scores or get out scores in their practice. I used to believe that was the first thing that just meant when now we've got two or three kids on the baseline, I'd say football. I'll talk over the ball, I'll get used to the noise, that's part of the game basketball anyway. Yeah, that's what distracts us in the game, noise and interference, and get them driven past to do while they're doing that, and they're ready to go and roll their heads up. Thanks for accepting the challenge, the lifelong challenge. See you later.